Everyone, thank you very much for coming along to this webinar on nickel alloy additive manufacturing, and specifically the characterisation and metallurgy of AM alloy 718. I'll just give a quick introduction to myself. I'm a project leader here at TWI, and I'm more focused in the metallurgy and characterization section within the organization, doing quite a lot of work with AM, but also with other materials as well, and also do quite a lot of fail investigations and things like that. So I'll start the presentation, and yes, I think there might be some time for Q&A at the end. So if you do have any questions, maybe use the Q&A function, and we'll try and come to that at the end. So hopefully my slides work okay. So just as way of just an outline of where we're going to go, I'll start with a quick introduction to TWI for those of you who may not know much about the organization. Then I'll talk a little bit about fundamental alloy 718 metallurgy, things more done from the wrought form, which is now being taken over to the AM form where applicable. Then give a little bit of background on some different AM processes and the different parameters and kind of things to be aware of with those. And then look at two specific areas looking at the metallurgy of AM 718. Firstly, looking at solidification microstructures and some work that we've done looking at that. And also then the effect of microstructure on properties. What do we have to be aware of? What are some of the areas of interest at the moment? How do you go about trying to connect those two things, microstructure and properties, which of course are so closely linked. So I'll start with a quick introduction to TWI. If my slides move on one. There we go. So TWI is one of the, is a research and technology organization. It's a global reach company, kind of often at the kind of cutting edge of different technologies. We cover quite a wide range of things. We originally came from welding. TWI originally came from the Welding Institute, although that's now a separate professional institution. TWI now does still a lot of joining, all different types of welding, from traditional arc processes to electron beam, friction stir, laser, and all others too. But also look at some other engineering processes, whether that's different coating techniques or a variety of other things as well. And also some more inherent materials and characterization things, that's including metallic and polymers and composites. And we do that to a wide range of industries, from kind of oil and gas to automotive, aerospace, defense, and many others as well. TWI is a membership-based organization, and we work for our members primarily, giving consultancy, advice, running projects. We're independent and therefore can be impartial, which is, I think, a big selling point for lots of people. It's not that we're getting loads of money in from a specific sector or a specific company. We can kind of take a step back. And we can give expert advice, know-how, help with some training, some safety assurance, and really work with different of our members to really try and help them with these different issues. We've got over 600 staff worldwide. We serve a lot of different industrial members and have been doing what we've been doing for quite a long time. 75 years or thereabouts. And the kind of a side part, as I mentioned, is the Welding Institute, which is a professional institution body, which itself has many thousands of members. TWI is based mainly in the UK, although as I'll show in a minute, it has a global reach. These are the main offices, the main one of which is in Cambridge. And I've just highlighted some different areas where we do different kind of additive specific things. So for example, in our base in Rotherham near Sheffield, we have our laser AM facilities, which includes laser powder bed fusion and some more laser DED processes. In our Wales office in Port Talbot, we do quite a lot of advanced NDT, and that often is used in AM parts, for example, doing some really nice high resolution CT scanning. The main activities, I guess, would be in Cambridge. That's the home of our wire arc additive manufacturing. Also do some cold spray additives, electron beam. And it's also the home of the bulk of the characterisation and testing facilities. And the other offices in Aberdeen, which concentrates more in training specifically for oil and gas. And in Middlesbrough as well, where we have some of our underwater diving training and also some surface tribology and other technologies there as well. As I mentioned, we also have a global presence. These are just some of the countries that we have bases, either for training or for other purposes as well. So enough about TWI for now. Let's move on to the main focus, which is alloy 718. This is one of the most commonly used nickel alloys and is a high strength nickel alloy and used in lots of different applications in various sectors. I guess originally it was an aerospace alloy primarily and was developed for elevated temperature performance in the aerospace industry, but it also is used in lots of other sectors, including the oil and gas sector, mainly for its corrosion resistance. So in addition to that elevated temperature performance and the corrosion resistance, it also exhibits a high toughness, it's weldable, and therefore very useful and across these different areas. Some of the things to bear in mind is it's got quite a high material cost, and that's at the moment going up by the day with the nickel price increasing quite a lot at the moment. It can also be quite difficult to machine, which therefore makes it quite useful to in an additive manufacturing applications, as it means that you can save some cost without having to machine, say, an intricate part. You could have a lot of wastage material in that. Whereas if you build it additively, you can build it to almost near net size as you go. And that can really help that process a lot. Another reason why I think alloy 718 is one of the primary AM alloys is because it's also a powder metallurgy alloy. And therefore, people are very used to handling 718 powders. And that fed quite nicely into some of the powder bed fusion and other techniques as well. Just to quickly give you a quick summary of the elemental breakdown of alloy 718, we can see here it's mainly based of nickel, but also quite significant amounts of chromium, iron, then some niobium, titanium, and then small amounts of titanium, aluminium, some carbon, some cobalt, and also other trace elements. Nickel's there mainly for its high melting point, which is why most of the super alloys are formed of nickel. What is also really attractive is that it has the same crystal structure, which is a face center cubic structure, all the way up to its melting point, which is really, really useful if you're having a part that's going to be cycled from, say, ambient temperature up to a really high temperature. A crystal structure change could introduce stresses, residual stresses, or even shape changes to that part, which would not be helpful. Nickel also has a good inherent corrosion performance. However, it is, as I mentioned before, quite expensive and increasingly so. I've just included a picture of an American nickel, the coin, as it's quite interesting that I think there's a problem there at the moment and the same in other coinages as well, in that the cost of nickel can make the raw materials of coins more worth more than the actual coin itself, which can lead to some problems. And of course, in other applications of nickel, it's something to bear in mind that it is quite an expensive alloy. The other additions, the aluminium, titanium, and niobium are primarily there for precipitation strengthening. I'll show you some of those precipitate phases in a moment. Molybdenum offers some solid solution strengthening as well. Chromium gives quite good corrosion resistance, especially in the kind of mid to upper ends of its service temperatures. Carbon enables some carbide formations, and cobalt has quite a complex effect, and there's quite a lot of work being done, but quite a lot more to do, I think, on really understanding the effect of cobalt. But I guess cobalt is kind of most similar to nickel out of these others in its function. So the strengthening phases which make up alloy 718, as I said, it's a precipitation strengthening alloy, and so it is normally used in the aged condition. Aging typically happens around 600 to 800 degrees C, Often a two-phase aging process is used, one at 720, one at 620. That's quite a common heat treatment that's used. And this whole heat treatment is to try and precipitate both gamma prime and gamma double prime precipitates. You can see in the image on the right, there's a grain boundary running in the middle, but either side of this is a phase field showing both of these phases. The gamma double prime tends to be slightly longer and more lens-shaped, and the gamma prime tends to be more globular or kind of round or even cube-like shapes. It can depend a little bit. The gamma prime is a face center cubic structure like the matrix. It's therefore quite coherent with the matrix and has aluminium, titanium, and niobium. These strengthening elements make up the structure along with the nickel. The gamma double prime has a BCT lattice structure, although still has quite a relatively good level of coherence with the matrix. And this is considered the main strengthening phase in alloy 718. This is, I guess, different from some other super alloys, which tend to be strengthened primarily through the gamma prime. It also means that alloy 718's service temperature is slightly lower than some of those alloys, as the gamma double prime dissolution temperature is lower than that of the gamma prime. Other phases also form. As I mentioned, some carbides, typically at grain boundaries, although not always. These can be useful to help pin boundaries to limit grain growth, but they can also be less helpful, especially in higher amounts, partially because they remove some of the niobium from the matrix, leading to a lower degree of the other strengthening phases forming. Other phases that also form are the Laves phase. Again, this is niobium rich, very niobium rich, and again, is often considered deleterious, as again, it can take some of the niobium out of the solid solution, which then when it comes to aging, means you get a lower percentage of the gamma prime, gamma double prime forming. Laves typically forms around 800 to 1000 degrees. It's quite a common phase that people are aware of in welding, and therefore it in AM as well, typically when it's cooled through this range. Delta is another phase. So you can see here in the picture on the right that the needle shape phases are delta, and the larvae tend to be a bit more globular. Delta is quite incoherent with the matrix. Again, it's often considered deleterious, partially because again, it's niobium rich and so depletes the matrix of this. But also in high amounts, it has been linked to drops in ductility and specifically hydrogen embrittlement susceptibility changes. However, delta can be useful in some applications. For example, in high temperature, it has been, some studies have shown that it can be useful in creep performance. Also, sometimes it seems to help with toughness as well. So deltas can go both ways and very much depends on the application that you'd like to use it for. So moving from kind of some of the fundamental 718 metallurgy to some AM processes, and then eventually we'll come to link the two together. So some of the most common AM technologies kind of fall into two camps. One, often described by this term directed energy deposition, or DED. That basically means that you have a heat source, an energy source, and you put your material directly into contact with that heat source, either in the form of a wire or a powder, and then it's then melted and then deposited onto the surface. So both this one on the left, DED arc, or sometimes known as wire plus arc AM or WAM, is using a conventional arc welding energy source. And I guess in simplified forms, it's basically depositing like a bead on plate multiple times to build up a bigger structure. So that's one of these DED processes. You can also do a similar thing with laser. And in laser, you can either use a wire or a blown powder to deposit. And also, you can also use an electron beam as well, as you see on the right-hand side. Although, of course, you would need a vacuum in order to successfully use that. So that can have some implications on the applications you might use it for. The other type is this one second from the left, laser powder bed fusion, or a few years ago, sometimes referred to as selective laser melting. This, I guess, is maybe more akin to the 3D printing techniques people think of when they think of polymer 3D printing. You effectively get a layer of powder, metallic powder, and then you trace the laser across it in the areas that you want to build. This then melts the powder in those regions into the structure below. Then you then get a new layer of powder and you repeat the process. And then eventually the powder that was never molten is removed through post-processing and you're left with your shape. So these are all fairly common techniques. There are other AM techniques as well that exist. I've just included some of these for today's presentation. And there's relative strengths and weaknesses of each of them. Just to illustrate this, one of those is in resolution. So using powder bed, either through laser or EB, you tend to get very fine resolution, which can be really useful, especially for intricate parts. Compare that to some of the electron beam or arc-based DED processes, you get a much higher resolution, or a much coarser structure, I guess. So maybe less good for intricate parts, but a lot better for building bigger parts. Because here you can see the deposition rate also tracks a similar way. So the powder bed fusion, while you can build intricate parts, it takes a long time. Whereas some of the processes on the other side, more of the DED techniques, can have a very high deposition rate, even though they may not quite have the resolution. So it all depends on exactly what you're looking for. So when we think about the properties of AM and therefore the applications you might want to use an AM material for, well, what's the thing that we need to be concerned about? Should we worry? Is there a concern at all? Well, this, I think, quite nicely illustrates one of the fundamental reasons why we do have to have an awareness of what the properties might be. You can see at the bottom of a build, by the time the whole build has been built, those individual areas will have been through multiple thermal cycles from the subsequent builds that were built on top of it, compared to the very top surface, which has only been through one thermal cycle, the cycle it experienced during deposition. This means that in different areas of a build, and if you have different geometries, different regions within that, have experienced a different thermal history. And that can lead to differences in microstructure, differences in residual stresses. And very quickly, you start to see that actually every single region of this material might be slightly different. And therefore, we need to understand what effect might that have on the properties and various properties. That affects both the solidification structure, also the sorts of phases that you might have. And especially in a material like 718, where you rely on many of those strengthening phases to give it its good mechanical properties, we do need to be concerned about some of these things. So how do we go about measuring them? Well, there's a variety of different characterization techniques that we can use. I've just included a few here, and many others are also used in AM applications. So firstly, NDT, I guess, is the most obvious. We can look for flaws, for cracks through a variety of NDT techniques. But sometimes we need to go further and not just look non-destructively, but also destructively. So in the same way you've characterized many other materials, you can use chemical analysis to look at the distribution of different elements, amounts of segregation in different regions. That can be really powerful and also a good check to make sure that what you've built is exactly what you think it has. You can look at the surface roughness. There's a strong driving force to be able to use AM parts in the as-built condition because that saves a lot of post-build machining. But what effect will the surface roughness have on its properties, like corrosion performance, for example? The mechanical properties, maybe the most obvious thing. How strong is it? Does that change in different orientations or different parts of a build? What's the ductility like? What's the impact toughness like? Again, we need to do some work to work this out. And how does that fit and change with the microstructure? Then we can use more microscopy techniques, whether that's using light microscopy or SEM, or more complex techniques like electron backscattered diffraction, where we can look at different grain orientations in different parts and see how the grain orientation changes to really help us see what is the structure like? What's the microstructure? What phases are there? What orientation of grains are there? How is that going to have an effect? And then ultimately, we can do some environmental testing, whether that's simulating a specific environment or doing some standard testing to compare our AM build with wrought material to give us a bit of an idea of how it might vary. And therefore, do we need to do more work? And of course, that can be in many different environments and conditions. So that's just a very quick flavor of some of the different characterization techniques that can be used. And I think it's really important that we do have an understanding of what our AM builds might act like, how they might perform before we use them. Although that, of course, depends on the application. If it's a very important application where if there's a failure, that could be catastrophic, then we have to have a greater confidence than perhaps if it's something that is less significant. So moving on. One key area of interest with AM builds, and specifically on the microstructure, is the solidification structure. How do grains grow through the material as you build up each layer? So there tends to be two ways that this can happen. And I've just made some really simplified versions of what the grain structure might look like. So for example, you've got, say you're halfway through a build, and one melt bead has this kind of profile. So with fairly long columnar grains throughout, but then often you get a skin on the top of finer equiaxed grains. When you then deposit the next layer, for example, like this, the question is, well, how is the microstructure going to compare to the layer before? Is it going to grow epitaxially, something like this? If that's the case, then if you then repeat this again and again, you can get very long grains elongated in the build direction, running all the way, sometimes all the way from the bottom to the very top. And it tends to be as they grow that specific grain orientations will become dominant. And therefore, you can end up with a very coarse grain structure elongated in this direction, which can have implications on its performance and its properties. We'll come on to that soon. And there tends to be a driving force to avoid this kind of microstructure. And we'd prefer to have something that's more refined, which therefore would be more isotropic. So for example, instead of that, we might prefer to have a grain structure where it renucleated grains at the when it's solidifying the next melt bead. And it's very difficult to avoid some level of columnar growth as the solidification front tends to run in the build direction. But if we had something like this, you can see that instead of having one single grain running all the way through the structure, you might get smaller regions where you get these slightly elongated grains, which would tend to be preferable. So here's an example in laser powder bed fusion alloy 718. You can see on the left-hand side a light micrograph image. And here you can see something of the remnants of the build structure. And here on the right-hand side is an EBSD map, which shows the orientation of different grains running there. You can see that there's not necessarily that much correlation between these two, as grains tend to grow, in this case, all the way through each melt pool profile. And you can see here that there's a lot of columnar grain, especially the grains orientated marked using this red orientation tend to be dominant and tend to grow up in long columnar structures. This is quite a typical solidification structure. As I said, you can see something of the original melt pool profile in this. And I think in this build, it had the laser ran and alternate layers either into the plane of the page or in the left to right direction, as you can see illustrated by the arrows. If you change that, that might change the solidification structure. So that's one variable you can bear in mind. Something else that's really important when we think about solidification is segregation. This shows some niobium segregation here at the interdendritic regions. So it seems to be that the niobium is expelled during the dendrite formation into the regions between each dendrite. This has quite a significant effect on phase formation later on and other performances as well, as we'll see. So we showed some solidification structures for a powder bed fusion. Well, how does that compare using other AM techniques? So here is a macrograph from an LMD build. I think this was a powder LMD build. Again, you can see the remnants of the melt pool profile here. If we then do an EBSD map of this, something like this, you can see how the grain structure changes. Now, I guess just to note that this is actually a really large EBSD map, and it was actually made up of stitching multiple maps together. So I think in the height, I think it had about 7 maps stitched together, and then it had about 5 or 6 separate rows or columns, as it would be in this orientation, to really build up this really lovely map, being able to show the bigger scale solidification patterns. So we can start to do this, and we can then compare different build processes, but also different parameters within those builds. So, and we can also do this both in one dimension, but also in other dimensions as well. So in this example here on the right, from this build, we sectioned both transverse to, so just to explain, the builds were kind of a brick shape. And so we sectioned in 3 orthogonal planes and then did EBSD on each of those. And then you can start to get a bigger idea of how the grain structure also changes in those different orientations. So just focusing on one orientation for now, here we can see similar work done with 3 LMD builds and 3 wire arc builds, each using different parameters. And you can see it's quite striking the difference between some of these. For example, in this LMD build, you have really large columnar grains, both kind of red being quite dominant in this region, and then the green grains dominant in this region, that run pretty much all the way from the bottom to the top of the build. If you then contrast this to this bottom right image in the wire arc, you can see a very different structure. It's almost as though every single bead that's deposited does renucleate a separate grain structure. So you don't get these large grains running all the way through. You get much smaller, finer grains that then give a more equiaxed overall structure. And the others in between are somewhere in between that as well. So just focusing on this in a bit more detail, for the LMD builds, this is work we did here as part of one of our core research projects at TWI. We varied the deposition rate. So this one on the left was done at 2000 millimeters per second, going up to down to 1500 and then to 1000. And so you can see that the differences in the parameter really have quite a difference in the solidification structure. Now, if we're to understand this more, it actually gets quite complicated because it's very difficult to split one variable from all the others. For example, if you change the travel speed of the laser, as we've done in this case, you're going to change the geometry of the melt pool. So on the left-hand side, you'd expect to have a much less deep but wider melt pool as you're moving faster. Compared to on the right, you're more likely to have a deeper but narrower melt pool. Now, solidification tends to be dependent on both the thermal gradient you have in place and also the velocity of the interface of the solidification as that occurs. But trying to evaluate what these two variables, how they vary, is quite difficult, because if you think about it, on the left-hand side, if you have quite not very deep, wide melt pools, you might have quite a high gradient of high thermal gradient in the build direction, whereas it'd be quite a lot lower in the horizontal plane. Compared to on the right-hand side, you'd expect to have in the vertical direction quite a smaller gradient, but then that would be different in the horizontal plane. So that's one variable you have. But also you have the variable of how you've deposited each bead from the previous layer in relation to the next layer. If you built directly on top of the previous ones, that might lead to preferential grains that were growing in one particular orientation, then being able to carry on. Whereas if you have a slight translation between layers, that can change it again. The exact location you are in the build also has an effect. You can see here on the right-hand side that you don't get the columnar grain growth you have near the edge of the sample that you got in the center. The travel speed also affects the amount of heat buildup you get in the build as it's growing. So that can also change the thermal gradients as well. So you start to see it's actually very difficult to predict what these are going to be like, and quite difficult to interpret exactly what's going on just by eye. I'll come on to how we can resolve that in a minute. Just a couple of things to note. As I mentioned earlier, you tend to get a small equiax grain structure right near the surface. This tends to be, I think, because you can get quite rapid cooling as it's exposed to the environment around. You can see this kind of skin here that you get on the top. Also to note, it's quite interesting that there doesn't seem to be any correlation between the orientation of the actual substrate and the at the bottom of the build and the first structures you get within the build. We can do the same thing for wire arc builds. Again, there was a difference here in the speed of deposition or the speed of the arc moving across. And this has, again, had a similar effect. And it seems to be that the lower speed you have, the more refined the grain structure. And you can see more clearly if we blow this up that there doesn't seem to be a huge amount of relationship between the grains forming in the previous melt pool to the next one in this right-hand example. However, as I mentioned, it does get quite complicated to work out exactly how to look at this and understand it. And this is really where modeling comes in. I don't think these videos, I tried this earlier and it didn't work. I had a couple of videos to show this, but anyway, it doesn't matter. And so you can look at this in different orientations and really starting to understand some of the physics, some of the energies involved, then can start to help you to build up models of exactly what's going on. You can then compare this to thermal data you get from the build and then the actual structure you get from EBSD to then try and validate that model and improve it to then start to be able to predict exactly what's going on. But I think there's so many variables involved, it's very difficult to do that without performing modeling. And we have a specific modeling team, specifically Tyler London and Maddie Allen, a couple of people who work very much on this in AM at TWI. So there'd be some contacts if you'd like to find out more about that. So moving on from some of the solidification structures to looking at the effect of microstructure on properties, how do these relate together and what do we do about it? How much do we understand so far in alloy 718? So I guess one thing to think about in terms of the microstructure are things like pores and other flaws. On the left-hand side here, we can see a build with quite a high level of porosity. These would typically be gas pores. Now, you can use parameter development within the process to try and minimize these, although it's very difficult to completely remove them. And so we then need to think about, well, what level is acceptable? And again, this very much depends on exactly what it's going to be used for. In some applications, a fairly high level of porosity might be absolutely fine. In a similar way to in a weld, you might get quite a few pores, but you don't have a concern. Whereas if you do have more of a concern, say, about its fatigue properties, then maybe you do have to have to try and reduce this further, as they may have an effect on that. It's the same with other flaws as well. Here on the right-hand side, we can see some cracking in an AM build, which appears to be quite hot cracking. Other flaws we can get are some lack of inter-run fusion between each subsequent build layer. Again, we can try and avoid these through parameter development, but we need to have some idea of exactly what is acceptable. And I think this is one of the challenges in AM is working out for different applications what those acceptability levels are. If we then think more widely, how do we compare AM parts to wrought parts? Well, there's going to be some differences, isn't there? As we've seen, the grain orientation might be quite different. In the as-built condition, here we can see this in an LMD build, is very different to the nice equiax fine grain structure we typically get from a well heat treated 718 part that might be from a plate or a bar. As I mentioned before, we tend to get dendritic structures forming, which can lead to segregation. This can lead to variations of the strength in different parts of the build, but also can lead to some less desirable phases forming. You can see here on the right-hand side, some Laves phase that's formed in the interdendritic region due to the niobium segregation that was present. That's going to have effect on potential properties. residual stresses as well are important to understand and to know and have a handle on too. And this really drives us to ask the question, well, how do we get this to become more like wrought? One easy way to understand this is if we can make it as close to wrought as possible, we have a reference point to compare it to. And for that, we'd have to apply some heat treatments. If we don't perform the heat treatment, here's some tensile proof strength data on electron beam melted sample. We can see some quite different effects in the perpendicular and the parallel directions to the build. This might be okay in some applications, but actually if you have quite an intricate AM part, it can get very difficult to actually work out which areas are going to have the highest stress and what the strength you can use in a model or in design, because it's not always that obvious to work out how different regions will compare to the build direction. So if we can remove that, that can be really helpful. So that does come onto heat treatment. But before I go there, I guess, again, sometimes you might be able to use these parts not heat treated, and there'd be a driving force to do that if possible. But in lots of applications, that isn't possible. So we do have to go down the heat treatment route. This table in the top left corner here shows some typical heat treatments used of wrought products. So very typically you'd have a solution heat treatment around the 970 to 1050 mark, say for 1 to 2 hours. There's quite a lot of variety there. That depends on the exact standard you use. Aerospace standards tend to have a lower temperature heat treatment, whereas some of the oil and gas would tend to have a higher one. That again depends on exactly what properties you need, whether you're caring more about high strength performance or more about hydrogen embrittlement or corrosion performance. And then an age, and here's a typical age, as I mentioned, 720 for 8 hours, followed by 620 age for 8 hours. But the problem is with AM is, well, how do we know that this well-defined, well-understood heat treatment for wrought products is going to be suitable for our AM in light of all those things we've talked about, the retained Laves phase? Will the heat treatment completely remove this because Laves phase isn't desirable? Will it completely remove segregation or to a level that's acceptable? What will it do to delta formation? If there's these regions with high niobium, that's likely to promote delta formation. Is that a problem? And where does the delta form? Delta tends to be less of a worry at grain boundaries, especially if it's not continuous, compared to those within grains. So that's something we also need to understand. Also, recrystallization. As we've seen, these really long grains are not tend to be desirable. So if we can have a heat treatment in the solution heat treatment that can completely recrystallize the structure, then we get nice, finer equiax grain structure, which we can understand and deal with more closely. Then lastly, grain growth is also a concern, because if we change the heat treatment too much, say go a lot higher temperature heat treatment to try and remove the segregation, to try and ensure that we don't have any Laves phase, to try and ensure we get full recrystallization, well, then we might get those recrystallized grains growing too much, and that will have an effect on the properties as well. For example, the mechanical properties or the creep performance. So here's an example of a laser powder bed fusion alloy that was subjected to the API6A CRA 150K heat treatment, which is very similar to the one I mentioned before. A solution age at kind of around 1020 to 1050, and then a two-step 720 degrees C, then followed by 620 degrees C age. And you can see here that it does, on the right-hand side, the EBSD map does seem to suggest that a large degree of recrystallization has occurred. We see these grains with quite distinctive twins there and tend to be quite equiaxed. So that seems good. There are some phases formed at the grain boundaries. Just from these images, it's difficult to know exactly what they are. It could be some carbides, it could be some delta. That could be a concern, especially if we're looking at more of a hydrogen embrittlement performance in the oil and gas sector. We then come on to the tensile properties and see that there is quite a difference between a wrought product and what you expect to what you get from the AM product. Specifically, you tend to get lower elongation, lower ductility, lower reduction in area values, and also a lower absorbed energy from Sharpie tests. This is also backed up by other work. That was work we've done at TWI. This is some other work from literature, which again shows the effect of heat treatment on the mechanical performance. So in the as-built condition, you get relatively, well, you get a lower strength than you'd get from a typical wrought product in the peak age condition, but you have quite a good elongation. If you then just perform a direct age, you don't worry about the solution treatment and just age the product, you get really good tensile strength, really high, but age drop and elongation. However, that drop isn't actually too much. And so for lots of applications, this would be perfectly acceptable. If you do the solution treatment first and then direct age, you get slightly lower strength, but a higher elongation. And then if you do a full stress relief heat treatment, which can be useful in AM applications, performed by hot isostatic pressing, homogenization solution treatment, and age, then maybe you get the best result of all. But that's quite a lot of effort to go to and may not be practical. So again, it all depends on exactly what you need to use this for. But it does show that there's, you can kind of tune the exact properties you need and can work around. If, for example, you just can't do a specific heat treatment, you might be able to get an acceptable property by doing something slightly different. There is a concern, though, in some sectors, particularly in the oil and gas sector, about, say, the elongation levels, as it's typically a 20% minima that's required, specifically to help with hydrogen embrittlement properties. And also in this work, it was reported that there was still some Laves phase in the as-built condition and quite a lot of delta after the heat treatment, which again is not, wouldn't be acceptable in some hydrogen embrittlement applications either. So these are all things to bear in mind. And on that, we've got some current work happening at TWI trying to optimize the heat treatment of AM718. This is done by one of my colleagues, Kostas, in the form of PhD, and now moved on to a core research project. And he's trying many different heat treatments, specifically looking at the solution heat treatment temperature, to try and work out what is the best temperature in light of some of these factors, the recrystallization, the ductility, the Laves dissolution, et cetera, et cetera. So that's work which is currently ongoing. And I think he's hoping to publish some of that fairly soon. So that would be really interesting. Again, specifically for oil and gas applications where some of the ductility values specifically are quite a concern. That's just one area. There's many other areas of environmental performance that we also worry about, maybe whether that's the corrosion performance, the high temperature performance, the sour service performance. And just as I close, I just wanted to talk about a couple of other projects that we currently have ongoing at TWI looking at these. One of these is another core research project, which is available to all TWI industrial members, specifically looking at the hydrogen embrittlement susceptibility of AM materials. It's specifically looking at hydrogen absorption due to using samples in under cathodic protection in a subsea environment. We're going to perform some slow strain rate tests using this NACE TMO198 standard to really look and compare to data already captured of wrought products to see, using this standard heat treatment, do we get acceptable properties. And then we're also going to utilize some of the work that I was describing from Kostas to then see if using a higher temperature solution anneal will have an effect to improve this. So this is quite interesting work, really trying to show how some of these microstructural features, some of the phases that are there, what effect will that actually have on a specific application here in using in a subsea environment under cathodic protection. And if this is positive, that really might help some of these AM products actually be able to be used in this environment and some confidence that they will perform well. Another project we have is more looking at the sour service performance. As I mentioned before, Alloy718 is often used in sour service areas and included in ISO 15156, NACE MRO175. And this is a joint industry project by a number of key oil and gas companies. And we're looking at laser powder bed fusion material from three different manufacturers. And we're going to be tested to look at the sour service performance, again, through some slow strain rate tests, in the hope that it might be able to go into a ballot to include AM material in these standards. So if this is something you'd be interested in finding out more about or even getting involved in, please do let myself or my colleague Bryony know, as this is really interesting work, again, looking at a specific application of AM and how some of these heat treatments, the microstructures, the phases there, will have this effect on its sour service performance. Now, of course, you could do this a similar project on other areas, whether that might be its creep performance or its dermal corrosion performance or intergranular corrosion, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a lot of work already out there on these things that we don't have time to go into today. Well, I think that's the end of the slides I've got. I think we do have a few minutes for any questions. So, Becky, how's the best way to do this?
Okay, do you want me to read them out for you?
Yeah, that'd be great if that's okay.
Okay, so the first one is how to distinguish gamma double prime phases from delta phases. Does only on the basis of their shape we can say the difference?
Thanks for that question. Yeah, it's interesting because the two different phases do have a very similar formation in terms of the elements that make them up. However, gamma double prime would tend to be an order of magnitude finer than delta. Delta, we often see these needles tend to be much easier to see, sometimes even under light microscopy and certainly under SEM. Whereas the actual gamma double prime tend to be very, very, very fine. And you have to go to kind of on the nanometer scale, and you have to go to very high magnifications to see them and to resolve them. And even kind of sometimes even up to kind of the TM level to get really to see them in much detail. So yeah, the gamma double prime tend to be a lot finer than the delta. It would probably be the easiest way.
Okay. Excuse my pronunciation, but how to identify Laves phase and carbides in the microstructure as they both are residing in the grain boundaries?
Yeah, again, thank you. Sometimes this can be difficult. Some carbides tend to have quite a distinct, a faceted structure, which can help. Laves tend to be a bit more globular. We can do some looking at some techniques like EDX, which looks at the X-ray characteristics, X-rays that are given off when you put an electron beam in the SEM onto it. Sometimes that can help distinguish between them, but sometimes it's very difficult, and you might have to use more sophisticated techniques. In some forms, it doesn't matter that much exactly what they are. Sometimes that really does matter, and so it's not always that easy to do that. But I think, again, you can often see Laves is quite distinctive from this kind of globular shape and tends to run in the interdendritic regions. And so that would be one quite clear way of being able to do so. But it's not always that simple.
Okay. Does constant heating reduce this problem? For example, holding apart at fixed temperature to reduce the thermal gradients?
It can do, and people do play around with different parameters to try and change this, whether that's heating the substrate that you're going to deposit onto beforehand, or having interpass dwells, or again changing the rate it's applied. I guess in each of these there is often a trade-off. So if you're going to go something a lot slower, you might be more prone to get cracking. So that can kind of set some boundaries. Also, just from a practical point of view, the slower you go, the longer it takes to build. There can be some quite sophisticated, just taking to a different alloy family to the titanium alloy family. Ti64 is again a common AM alloy. A lot of work's also been done at trying to remove these columnar grains in there. And some people have used some quite interesting, whether it's peening between each individual layer, or trying to do many other things as well to try and remove these columnar grains. Sometimes this is successful, but then it always begs the question, well, is it actually going to be useful in an application? Because if you have to do some fancy thing between every single layer, it's going to really limit how big a part you can practically build. So yeah, there are different things that people do try and to various success. I guess what is quite interesting in some of the work that we showed here is that through quite simple changes in parameters, you can get quite different solidification structures, which is maybe a distinctive of 718 and therefore makes that process a bit easier, because there does seem to be some level of control just from changing some of the more simple parameters.
Thank you. There's quite a few, so I'll go through as many as I can. Is it possible to use alloy 718 in powder bed fusion electron beam? In that case, I think it would be possible to reach the precipitations that you mentioned.
Yes, I think it can be used in electron beam powder bed fusion. I don't have very much experience of looking at builds using that technique myself. On the exact detail of the question, I'm not entirely sure, but yeah, I think it can be used. And if you'd like to, feel free to drop me an email. I'll put my, if I move on a slide, actually, my email address is here. So if you have any specific question like that, feel free to drop me an email and I can see what I can find out.
Okay, thank you. Is it possible to develop a IN718 with a good resistance to hydrogen embrittlement and low larvae phase by a AM process?
So I guess that's one of the kind of goals. And I think through careful heat treatment, it has been done. I think it's very difficult to completely remove larvae phase in the as-built condition. But if you do the right heat treatment, you can tend to be able to remove that larvae phase. So I think that has been done. But that's generally of interest as larvae is generally considered deleterious.
I think the LMD travel speed is not correct. It says 2000 double M per second. I think it is 2000 double M per minute.
Yeah, that sounds actually, when I think about it, I'll check that. I think if we send the slides out, I'll make sure that's correct before they go. Because that is very fast. I'll check that. I it was one of my colleagues who actually did that deposition. I'll check the data. Thanks for flagging that up.
Yeah, well spotted. Can you freely join DED NI alloy parts by welding?
Interesting question. That's an area that we're currently doing some work. It's for a specific client, so I'm afraid I can't really share that much. But that's a project we currently have running, looking at joining of AM parts through welding. We have done some work on that. And I think in 718, it tended to look okay, but we didn't do extensive testing. I guess if we look at wire arc DED processes, you could argue that it's not just welding, but it has very similar properties to welds because it's inherently based from the same technique. And so I think that would maybe give people a greater confidence that joining these things together through a wire arc DED technique might be okay. Say if you had a blown powder laser DED technique, I think that would potentially have more issues, especially from porosity. Some work has suggested that you can get some, say, trapped hydrogen from the surface of the powder in its form into the structure, which then can come out as pores during welding after building. But that's a kind of interesting area that that we're doing some work in, and would like to do some more work in as well. So yeah, that's something we're really interested in at the moment. So yeah, feel free to get in touch if that's raised anyone's kind of interest.
What are the hydrogenation parameters of TY project of 150K IN718?
Yeah, so we're using the technique that we're using is using cathodic protection to charge the samples, and doing that simultaneously whilst performing the slow strain rate test, as detailed in the standard NACE TMO 198. So it's from CP. Another part of that project is also looking at doing charging using gaseous hydrogen before doing some slow strain rate testing. I don't think that's going to include 718 at this stage, but hopefully that's something we could do because, again, that would be quite of interest. I guess moving away from oil and gas and more to other industries as well, although also interested in the oil and gas sector as well, just less subsea use. Yeah.
Okay, a few more. What are the larvae phase percentage for different technique builds
did API 6ACRA heat treatment dissolve all larvae?
So two parts there. The first one, the percentage, that would tend to vary between exact builds, exact parameters. I don't want to give a number off the top of my head because it might not be right, but I think some of the pictures I showed kind of showed it wasn't that huge, but it's still, like, for example, in the API 6ACRA standard, it says that no larvae phase is allowed for wrought products. So there is some there, and it's quite difficult to build without any, I think. Did the 150K heat treatment remove it? It appeared to, yes. But again, that might depend on exact builds. So, and in literature, lots of people have done work on heat treatments, and there can be some differences in results from build to build around that kind of mark heat treatment. Certainly, if you went a bit higher, you'd expect full dissolution. But some people reported some larvae phase even after heat treatment about 1080, I think. I think it can depend on the exact build parameters that you've used.
Okay. Can you comment on the recyclability, reusability of the NI powder? What precautions need to be considered during the AM process?
Interesting question. I tend to get less involved in the actual process of it. And so that's probably something I can't answer directly now. It's something I can go away, and if the person who asked that question wants to drop me an email, I'd be happy to look into it and have a chat with some of my colleagues who are more so. I think there would have to be cautions though, in that if the powder has seen a level of heat or seen a environment that isn't completely controlled, you could get oxidation or other effects, and it could lead to some of the powder quality degradation. So I think you'd want to be cautious about it, but exactly whether that happens and when, I'm not that sure. But yeah, feel free to drop me an email and I can do some digging and ask some of my colleagues on that.
Okay, thank you. Is hot cracking an issue in 718, and according to you, what are the main reasons?
Interesting. I think it can be an issue, although I think there has been a lot of progress in this regard. And I think, therefore, in a practical point of view, if you've got the right parameters, I think you can tend to avoid it without too much trouble. So in that sense, it may be considered not a huge issue, but I think you have to make sure you have the parameters right. I guess it would be analogous to welding. The reason for it, especially if it was kind of solidification cracking, to do with the residual stresses present, to do with the cooling rates, whether it happened or not. But for example, compared to if you're going to do a build with, say, 304 stainless steel, you'd expect 718 to have an inherently higher crack susceptibility. But there's many examples of people who've managed to avoid it. So I don't think if you optimize the parameters, you can tend to avoid it. I guess part geometry could also have an effect as well, but that would be through the residual stresses that were formed.
Right, and the last one, you mentioned the difference between having long communal growth grains across multiple layers and having separation between those commoner grains by a skin of smaller grains. Is that effect common in other non-nickel alloys used in LPBF?
The examples I gave were from LMD and wire arc. I think I'm not sure it would be quite as prevalent in powder bed fusion because you tend to have much finer size melt pools. It does seem to be quite common in some of the DED processes. Although I guess it's worth noting that small layer would tend to be melted in the subsequent build of the next layer. So you only really see it at the very top layer. But I've seen it in 316 builds as well. So I don't think it's such an uncommon thing. But again, it seems to occur due to cooling rates from the surface. And so it would depend on between different alloy structures. But I've definitely seen it in 316 as well as 718.
That's great. That's all the questions, Joe. So thank you very much.
Excellent. Well, thank you everyone for coming. I hope that's been of interest.
It's great. Thank you. And just to let you know, we will be sending out a link to the recording and the presentation with Joe's contact details on in the next couple of days.
Excellent. Thank you very much, all.
Thank you. Bye.